Hallelujah, glory be to God. Good evening, everyone. It's another time of worship in His presence. You're welcome. This is the King's Chamber, the Citadel of Favor, and it's a midweek service that equipping the saints and our communion service. You know, in this time, we are taught of God and impacted of God Himself. We also break the bread and we partake of the communion. As we go ahead, I ask that the Spirit of the Lord will go with us in the name of Jesus. Let's listen to this worship song. Hallelujah.
Longing just to bring something that's a word that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within. Through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I It's all about you, Jesus.
Hallelujah, you're welcome once again. Let us pray. Our Father and our Lord, we want to thank you for the gift of life. We want to thank you for the time you have helped us. We want to thank you for going out and coming in today. We want to thank you for how far you have helped us today. We want to thank you for life, for safety, for security. We want to thank you for going out and for coming in. Jehovah, we say, be thou exalted in the name of Jesus. Our Father and our Lord, as we go into your word today, we ask that you would speak to us yourself in the name of Jesus. We ask that you would help us, you would enable us, you open our understanding, you will help us to hear you directly in the name of Jesus. We ask that which we hear today, we would run with it in the name of Jesus. And so, our Father, we vow to give all the praise and all the glory to your name at the end of this service. In Jesus' most precious name, we have prayed. Amen. Glory be to Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Good evening. Once again, you're welcome to the service this evening. Praise the name of Jesus. And so today we'll be speaking on a very beautiful topic. You know, we'll be speaking on heart and signs of worship. Heart, A-R-T. Heart, A-R-T, and signs of worship. Heart and signs of worship. That is the mode of worship. How should we worship God? What should we do to draw God's attention? And, you know, for the couple of the weeks, of the remaining weeks, we'll be running this series, and it's been divided into three parts. You know, today we'll be laying the foundation of it. We'll be starting with the introduction, knowing your God. Praise the name of Jesus. Yes, we'll be starting with the introduction today, knowing your God. Who is your God? How do you know your God? Because if you don't know the God you have, if you don't know the God you serve, you would not know how to worship him. That is just a fact. You know, and the following Wednesday, I beg your pardon, we'll be doing what is worship. And what does worship entails? You know, we'll be treating that topic on a large scale. You know, and I would encourage us not to miss any parts of this series, because it's going to be eye-opening and it's going to help us in our worship with our Father. And the third part, we're going to be talking about reason you need to worship God. You know, why do you need to worship God? The Bible says we are created to worship him. Aside that, why? What are other reasons you need to worship God? I pray the Lord will help us. The Lord will open our understanding. The Lord will open our hearts and enable us to have an understanding of his word as we are teaching, as we are on this series. Each and every one of us will have a rhema of his word in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory be to Jesus. Amen. Okay, so today, as I said earlier, we'll be starting with the introduction, knowing your God. Knowing your God. Knowing your God. I'm sure you'll be asking yourself, yes, I know my God. He's my God and I know him. But, you know, by the time we go into in-depth of it, we will know if truly we know our God or not. Praise the name of Jesus. And I'll be asking us a couple of questions, which I know at the end of today's, you know, midweek service, we would be able to have answers to those questions. If you do not have answers to them before, by the time we are running through this series, by the time we are done with this series, you have answers to knowing your God, you have answers to how you should worship your God, and you have answers to reasons why you should worship God. Praise the name of Jesus. So this evening, I want us to open our Bible to John chapter 4, verse 23 to 24. John chapter 4, verse 23 to 24. John chapter 4, verse 23 to 24. And I read, "But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." John chapter 4, verse 23 to 24. That was just what we read. And that place is telling us about worship, that the hour cometh when the Father, our God, our Maker, when he will be looking for the true worshippers. Now the question is, are you a true worshipper? Do you worship him because you need something from him? Do you worship him because he is God? Do you worship him because that is why you are created? Praise the name of Jesus. Our second Bible reading is Daniel chapter 11, verse 32b. Daniel chapter 11, verse 32b. Daniel 11, verse 32b. Praise the name of Jesus. That was Daniel speaking in this place. He says, "But the people that know their God, they shall be strong and they shall do exploits. Praise the name of Jesus. Those that know their God shall be strong and they shall do exploits. Our third reading for tonight shall be taken from Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. It's a common scripture, and I'm sure many of us, you know, we would know it by heart. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. And it says that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his sufferings, be made conformable unto his death. I will take that again. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, be made conformable unto his death. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Now I will ask us a question. I need us to get our journals and pen these things down. Who is God to you? Who is God to you? We are running on a series of art and science of worship. Art, A-R-T, and science of worship. And today we are laying a solid foundation of introduction parts, which is knowing your God. Knowing your God, for the benefit of those that are just coming online, which is knowing your God. Praise the name of Jesus. And I just ask us a question now, that who is your God? Who is your God? How do you know God? That's a question you should answer. Pen it down and put the answers down in your journal. And for me here, I said God is the creator of the universe. Hallelujah. His love is revealed in providing eternal life for all through Jesus Christ. God is the creator of the universe. He created the seas, the firmament, the heart. If you go back to Genesis chapter 1 from verse 1, it talks about the things God created, the light, the first day, what he created on the first day, what he created on the second day, on the third day, the fourth day, the fifth day, the sixth, and on the seventh day when he rested. God created everything. So God is the creator of the universe. He's a creator whom no man created. Hallelujah. He is a creator whom no man, nobody created him. His love is revealed in providing eternal life for all through Christ Jesus. Glory. God is unique. You know, he is unique in his ways. He's unique in his doing. He's unique in his heart. No person or object or idea can be compared to him. He's incomparable. He is incomparable. You can't compare God to anything. He's incomparable. There's nothing that is the most beautiful thing on this earth was created by God. So there's nothing you can compare him with. He is majestic in his ways. Praise the name of Jesus. I'm still talking on who is God. God is majestic in his ways. If we look at Psalm 93, verse 1 to 5. Psalm 93. Verse 1 to 5. Is majestic in his ways. The Psalms is a very good, you know, is a very good book to go through when you want to know who God is, because David took his time out, you know, to explain God from his power to his works to his heart to his splendor to his glory to his majesty. Psalm 93 verse 1 to 5. Hallelujah. It says, the Lord reigneth. He is clothed with majesty. The Lord is clothed with strength, wherewith he had guarded himself. The world also established, that it cannot be moved. Glory. Thy throne is established of old. Thou art from everlasting. The floods have lifted up, O Lord. The floods have lifted up their voice. The flood lifts up their waves. The Lord on high is mightier than the noise of many waters, yea, than many waves of the sea. Praise the name of Jesus. Thy testimonies are very sure. Holiness becometh thine house. Holiness becometh thine house, O Lord, forever. That is the psalmist telling us how majestic God is. Telling us how even the waves of the sea sing his praises. How the flood raise up their voices. telling us how he is clothed in majesty. You know, the songwriter, there's this particular song that says, Alagbada, you know, he that is clothed with fire. Hallelujah. When you know God, you have life. In other words, God is life. God is life. Who is God? God is life. John chapter 17 verse 3 tells us. John chapter 17 verse 3. John chapter 17 and verse 3. And this is eternal life, that they might know thee only through God and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. God is spirit. Yes. God is spirit. He is not materialistic. He's not material or physical as we are. As a spirit, he does not have limitations. God is limitless. He cannot be held bound. He cannot be constrained in a place. He is limitless. You know, the Yobas will elogize him and say, Joro joro fenfe fenfe kabiti kabiti awolule bi ate ileke. You know that he is big, he is mighty, he is large. You know, you cannot contain him. Praise the name of Jesus. God is the highest form of existence. That is why we call him again, he is the ancient of days. Agbogbojo is the ancient of days. The book of John again, chapter 4, verse 23 to 24, which was what we read earlier. Let's look at 2 Corinthians, chapter 3, verse 17 to 18. God is the ancient of days. 2 Corinthians, chapter 3, verse 17 to 18. 2 Corinthians, chapter 3, verse 17 to 18. He says, Now the Lord is that spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Verse 18. But we all are open face to face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, and are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as the Spirit of the Lord. Hallelujah. God is the creator and the maker of all things. God is the creator and maker of all things. Colossians chapter 1, verse 16 to 17. There are other scriptures, but I would like us to read Colossians 1, 16 to 17. Colossians 1, 16 to 17. Hallelujah. It says, for by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. Verse 17, and he is before all things, and by him all things are consistent. Hallelujah. Let's look at Genesis 1. We will not be reading this, but I'll just give us the scriptures so in our own time we could go back to them. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. Genesis chapter 1, verse 7. Also talk about, you know, God being the creator of all things. Genesis chapter 1, verse 16. Genesis chapter 1, verse 25. Genesis chapter 1, verse 27. And Genesis chapter 2, verse 2 to 4. I'll take that again. Genesis 1, 1. Genesis 1, 7. Genesis 1:16, Genesis 1:25, Genesis 1:27, and Genesis chapter 2, verse 2 to 4. Again, I have here that he is the only living and true God. He is the only living and true God. The psalmist says, there are other gods, they have eyes and they cannot see. They have hands, they cannot use them. They have legs and they cannot walk. And they that made them are like them. He is the only and true God. He is the only and true living God. every other god are dead. Every other gods are dead. Isaiah chapter 44, verse 6 to 8. Isaiah chapter 44, verse 6 to 8. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first and I am the last, and beside me there is no God. And who as I shall call and shall declare it, set it in order for me. Excuse me, since I appointed the ancient people and the things that are coming and shall come, let them show unto me. Fear ye not, neither be afraid. Have I not told thee from time, and have I not declared it? Praise the name of Jesus. Have I not told thee from time, and have I not declared it? Ye are even my witness. Is there a God besides me? There is no God. I know not any. Hallelujah. Is there a God beside me? There is no God. I know not any. That is the Spirit of God talking, speaking through Isaiah. Praise the name of Jesus. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 4 to 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 4 to 6. God is the only and true God. We are still speaking about who is God. God is the only true living God. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 4 to 6. It says, as concerning therefore the eating of those things that are offered in sacrifice unto idols, we know that an idol is nothing in the world, and that there's none other God, but there is one. For though there be are called gods, whether in heaven or in earth, as there be gods, many lords, and many gods, gods with small letter G. But to us there is but one God, the Father of whom we are all things, and we in him, one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we are all things, and by him. Albeit, there is not in any man that knowledge that is knowledgeable, for some of conscience of the idol unto this hour eat the things that is offered unto idol and their conscience. Praise the name of Jesus. That verse is telling us that God is the only God, and there is no other God besides him. You know, we have the song that says, there is none besides thee, O God, none as holy as the Lord. We bless you, Lord, we exalt you, and we magnify your name. Praise the name of Jesus. In knowing God, you need to know his attributes. You need to know who he is. You need to know what his characters are. You need to know who his person is. You need to know what his nature is all about. You need to know everything about him. You know, it's like when a man is getting married to a woman, what happens? He gets to know everything about her. He gets to know her hometown. He gets to know the father's name. He knows the mother's name. He knows her past. He knows she shares her future with him. She tells him the present. You know, there's no secrets. Praise the name of Jesus. And so now we'll be looking at the nature or the attributes or the characteristics of God. Number one, God is immutable. God is immutable. He never changes. Malachi chapter 3, verse 6. Malachi chapter 3, verse 6. God is immutable and he never changes. You know, that song says, you are the same yesterday, today, forever. Nobody is like you. Oh, you never change. Yesterday, today, forever. Nobody loves me like you. I worship you. I worship you. For you are the living God. Glory. Malachi chapter 3, verse 6. It says, "For I am the Lord, I changeth not. Therefore, ye sons of Jacob are not consumed. I am the Lord, I changeth not. Therefore, ye sons of Jacob are not consumed." The Lord never changes. You know, the world around us changes. The world around us go in and out and in. The world around us is variable, but God remains the constant one. He never changes. Like the song I just sang, He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He remains the same. There's no variable of shadow or turning in Him. Praise the name of Jesus. Let's the book of Hebrews chapter 13, verse 7 to 8. The book of Hebrews chapter 13, verse 7 to 8. We'll not be reading it, but I'll give us the scriptures. James chapter 1, verse 17. James chapter 1, verse 17. Psalm 90, verse 2. Psalm 90, verse 2. Psalm 102, verse 26 to 27. I love to read that. Psalm 102, verse 26 to 27. It says, "They shall perish, but thou shalt endure. Yea, all of them shall wax old like a garment. As a vesture shall thou change them. Thou shalt be changed. But thou art the same, and thy years have no end." Makashataya. Is somebody hearing that? Thy years have no end. Thy years have no end. But thou art the same. Thy years have no end. Psalm 102, verse 26 to 27. That tells us that God still remains the same. Another attribute of God is powerful. God is powerful. That song says, "There is power in your name. Miracles happen in your name. As we lift our voice in praise, it's you that we see. It's you that we see." There is power in his name. God is powerful. We can only see a small measure of his power, but we can never know it all. That is why he is God. You know, the way Moses said to him, he said, "Lord, I want to see your glory." He said, "Lord, show me your glory." And the Lord said to him, "You know what? You cannot see my face. You cannot see my face, but I will show you my glory." He said, "When I'm passing, I will hide you with the back of my hand. You know, I will hide you. And when I'm gone, when I passed by, you would see just the very feral of my glory. Not the real glory, not the real glory, not the real face of God, but you will see the very feral." And Bible says that when Moses saw that and he came down from the mountain, the Bible says his eyes shone. His eyes shone. Praise the name of Jesus. We can never know the full extent of God's power. God is all powerful. He's omnipotent, the all powerful. He's omniscience, the all knowing. He knows all things. There's no secrets with him. You cannot hide anything. Are there things you do in the secrets, in your secret place, and you think, "Oh, nobody saw me"? Well, God didn't see me. I need to tell you that you're deceiving yourself, because the all knowing, the all seeing God, he knows it all. Praise the name of Jesus. He is the omnipresent, the ever present one. He is in the past, is in the present, and is in the future. Praise the name of Jesus. God is powerful. He's self-existent. He's self-sufficient. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 61. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 61. Job chapter 26, verse 7 to 14. Psalm 147, verse 4 to 5. Jeremiah 10, verse 12 to 13. Romans chapter 1 and verse 20. 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 20. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. I will take those scriptures again. 2 Chronicles 20, 61. Job 26, 7 to 14. Psalm 147. We'll be reading that later. Psalm 147, verse 4 to 5. Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 12 to 13. Romans chapter 1, verse 20. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 20. And Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. We'll be reading Psalm 147, verse 4 to 5. Psalm 147, verse 4 to 5. And it says, He telleth the numbers of the stars, He calleth them all by their name. Great is our Lord, and of great power. His understanding is infinite. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That is how powerful God is. Praise the name of Jesus. The pride of God, the power of God buries the pride of men. You know, if you gather the most powerful men together in the world, put them together, they are not enough to be compared. They are not enough. They are not enough. They are not powerful enough to be as powerful as our God. The power of God buries the pride of men. Let me explain that. If you look at the account of the children of Israelites, you know, the Red Sea and Pharaoh. You know, when they got to the sea, they had to cross. And of course, they were afraid and they were looking back that, oh, at our front is the Red Sea. And behind us is the Egyptians. What do we do? You know, and the Lord said to them, oh, you children of Israel, you know, today, the Egyptians you see today, you see them no more. The same power that parted the Red Sea into two, that made a wall and gave the children of Israel a pedestal, gave them a smooth tarred road to walk on, is the same power that drowned the Pharaohs. You know, they went into the sea with them because they were proud. They went into the sea with the children of Israel that, you know what, we would follow you. And guess what? The same power that parted the sea did what? Brought the waters together and they were consumed in their pride. Praise the name of Jesus. The power of God buries the pride of men. God is self-sufficient. He has no needs. John chapter 5 verse 26. I like us to read that part. God is self-sufficient. He does not need our money. He does not need our designer clothes. He does not need our bags. He does not need our resources. He does not need our properties. But there's one thing He needs: our hearts. John chapter 5, verse 26. God is self-sufficient. John 5:26. He says, For as the Father hath life in himself, so hath he given to the Son to have life in himself. He has no need. As humans, we have incredible needs, yes, which are unfulfilled. But God has never been in need. For not even for once. God is perfectly complete in his own being. Hallelujah. Self-sufficiency of God means he possesses the infinite riches of wisdom and power all to himself. Genesis chapter 17 verse 1, I beg your pardon. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 16. Praise the name of Jesus. Another attribute of God is he is wise. He's wise, perfect, and unchanging in wisdom. Romans 11:33. He says, Oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments, and unfathomable his ways. The wisest man on earth cannot come close to being as wise as God. Hallelujah. God is infinitely wise, consistently wise, perfectly wise. You know, the wisdom of God has the ability to perfect and to achieve those ends by the most perfect means. I'll say that again. The wisdom of God has the ability to devise perfect ends and to achieve those ends by most perfect means. He sees the end of a thing right from the beginning. So when you are fretting about a thing that, hey, I don't know how this thing will end, God already knows the end of it right from the start. The wisdom of God has made man to realize how limited our wisdom is, or are, and how finite, how small our wisdom is. I need to move a little bit faster. Hallelujah. God is good. You know, we all know that song, God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. He is infinitely and unchangeable kind, and is full of goodwill. Psalm 34 verse 8. In fact, you could read the entire Psalm. There's Psalm 34 verse 8 and there's Psalm 38. Psalm 38, I'll like us in our own time, go through the entire Psalm 38 to know how good God is. Another attribute is God is merciful, is compassionate, is kind. Romans chapter 9 verse 15 to 16. Let's read that. Romans chapter 9. Romans chapter 9 verse 15 to 16. For he said to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy on. I will have compassion, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. So then it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy. Hallelujah. But of God that showeth mercy. God is full of mercy. He is unfailing, merciful. His loving kindness is compassionate towards us. Praise the name of Jesus. Without the mercy of God, we would have no hope of heaven. Yes, without the mercy of God, we will have no hope of heaven. And we will be condemned to death because of our disobedience. Romans chapter 3 verse 23. You know that song says, great is your mercy towards me, your loving kindness towards me, your tender mercies day after day. Another attribute of God is God is gracious. Psalm 145 verse 8. God is gracious. Grace is a part of God which is not just an action. Grace is eternal. His grace is something we do not earn. Yes, he gave it to us. It is a gift. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 8. His grace is sovereign. Exodus chapter 33 verse 19. God is faithful. Yes, God is faithful. There's no unfaithfulness in him, and we dare not compare him to the standard of men. God is faithful, and he's too faithful to fail us. We have a faithful creator. 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 13. Deuteronomy 7 verse 9. Psalm 37. 1 Peter chapter 4 verse 19. Psalm 89 verse 8, Psalm 36 verse 5. I will take those scriptures again. 2 Timothy 2:13, Deuteronomy 7:9, Psalm 37, the entire, Psalm 37, 1 Peter 4:19, Psalm 89 verse 8, Psalm 36 verse 5. No one has ever trusted him in vain. Yes. The faithfulness of God, no one has ever trusted him in vain. Abraham trusted him. Daniel trusted him and he brought him out of the fire. Abraham trusted him and he had the child, Isaac. David trusted him when he was in the desert and God kept him, Psalm 23. You know, that song says, you are too faithful to fail me. You are too faithful to disappoint me. You've proven yourself in my life, and I've come to realize that you are too faithful. Yes, you are too faithful to fail. Hallelujah. God is holy. Habakkuk chapter 1 verse 3. Revelation 4:8. Of all the attributes of God, holiness is what uniquely describes him. We could look at Leviticus chapter 11 verse 43 to 45 also, and Exodus chapter 3 verse 1 to 6. God is holy. Now, how do you know your God personally? This is where I'm coming to. How do you know your God personally? Do you know him personally, or you know him by what people have said he is? Have you experienced him personally? Can you say, oh yes, I have experienced God, and I can say that God is good? The first step in knowing God personally is there has to be a deep desire in you. Praise the name of Jesus. The first step in knowing God personally. Because if you don't know him personally, there's no way you are going to worship him. If you don't know him personally, there's no way you will know how to worship him. Number one, there has to be deep desire to know him. There has to be a longing. Philippians chapter 3 verse 10, part of the opening scripture that we read, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, be made conformable unto that. That I may know him. There has to be a deep desire. You know, that song says, as the deer panted for water, so my soul longeth after you. Are you longing for God? If you really want to know him personally, then there has to be a longing in you. There has to be a panting. There has to be a yearning. There has to be a deep desire. Psalm 42 verse 1 to 2. You know, another song says, I want more of you. I want more of you. I want more of you, Jesus. The more I know you, the more I want to know you, Jesus. More of you. There has to be a yearning. You have to desire to know him more. Praise the name of Jesus. Another step in knowing God personally, there has to be an intimate fellowship. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 18. Let's read through that. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 18. There has to be an intimate fellowship. The second point, first point in knowing God, there has to be a deep desire. Second point in knowing God, there has to be an intimate fellowship. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 18. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as the Spirit of the Lord. Praise Jesus. The word fellowship means koinonia in Greek, you know, and you could liken it to the copulation of man and woman when they are married. The intimacy, you should have that kind of intimacy. There has to be an intimate relationship with God if you want to know him personally. You know, when you want to know somebody, when you love somebody and you just want to know him, want to know them, what do? You are always around them. You don't just say hi to them once in a black moon. You are always around them. You always want to check up on them. You are often found with them. You can't be a Sunday diaprene if you want to have a personal knowing with God. If you want to know God personally, you cannot be a Sunday diaper. It cannot be. It's only when you come to church on Sunday that is when you carry your Bible. It cannot be. And one of the ways of having intimate relationship with God is observing your quiet time. Am I shocking somebody there? Yes. It is observing your quiet time. I'm sure if a survey is to be taken with Christians to know how many Christians do have their quiet time, we'll be amazed at the number we'll come to. But really, we should have an intimacy with God. And the best time, the best way you can do that is through quiet time. Now, what is quiet time? I said it is a regular appointment we keep with God. Yes, it is a personal regular appointment you keep with God. Now you know the time you go to work, you know the time you eat, you know the time you call a friend, you know the time you come to church. Same way you have a time with God, just you and God alone. You know, and during that time, it blocks you out of all distractions and allow you to focus and connect with Jesus alone. And during this time, what do? You pray, you meditate on the word, and you worship. You know, you pray, you speak to him, you listen. He speaks back to you. I tell people that, you know, that you determine your day from your quiet time. Yes. I remember someone was asking me some times ago that, okay, so how do you do this thing? You keep saying quiet time. How do you do it? And I said, you know, just pick a convenient time with you and God. It could be in the middle of the night. It could be early in the morning. It could be in the afternoon. So far, you will not be distracted at that time. And you are consistent with that time. When you are very consistent, when it gets to that time, you will always have a nudging. I tell her I have my quiet time within 3 and 5, between 3 a.m. and 5 a.m. And she was like, with the nature of your work, how do you cope? How do you do that? And you still go to work early in the morning. I said, yes. When is that time? There's always a nudging. No matter how sweet that sleep is, there's a nudging and I just get up. Now, you don't get to that point until there's consistency. Praise the name of Jesus. You don't get to that point until there's consistency. Another point in knowing God personally is scriptural revelation. You begin to study the word and you have the rhema. You'll be reading Psalm 23 verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want, for a very long time. And the day you propose to read it with the whole of your heart, and like, God, I want to have a rhema in this thing. By the time you read it, it opens your eyes of understanding, and you have a better understanding of what Psalm 23 verse 1 is all about. Praise the name of Jesus. 1 Samuel chapter 3 verse 21. You know, Samuel was studying the word, and the Lord revealed himself to him through the word. Praise the name of Jesus. Joshua chapter 1 verse 8. We all know that this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, thou shalt meditate on it day and night. Another point in knowing God personally is building your faith in God. Is somebody hearing that? Building your faith in God. Building your faith in God. The book of Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 6. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 6. I like to read that part. Hebrews 11, 6. But without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. You need to believe that he is. You need to build your faith. You need to start from the place of headache. The same faith you use to heal headache is the same faith you use to heal cancer. There's no big faith, there's no small faith. You just need to believe that he will do it. He has said he will do it. And I'm rest assured in his promise that he will do it. You must have faith in him, believing that he can do all things and he will do all things. Praise the name of Jesus. It means we have to trust him completely, absolutely. Including his promise, including his standards. We have to trust him absolutely without having an ounce of doubt. In knowing God and in knowing him personally, faith, trust is key. The way a husband will trust, the way the man will trust his wife, the way the woman will trust the husband. The way a child will trust the father to throw him or her up and know that, oh, I know my father will catch me, he won't let me fall. Absolute trust, absolute faith. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 to 6. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 to 6. Proverbs chapter 3, verse verse 5 to 6. Hallelujah. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and with all your understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your path. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 to 6. Hallelujah. Yes, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Verse 6, in all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. Praise the name of Jesus. Romans chapter 10, verse 17. Romans 10, verse 17. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Hallelujah. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing of the word of God. You know, the last point I have here in knowing God personally is do what pleases God. Glory to Jesus. Do what pleases God. Do what pleases God. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 3. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 3. Do what pleases God. Obey His commandments. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 3. Do what pleases God. Obey His commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not grievous. Meaning, whatever commandment the Lord has given to us to keep, He knows we are able to do it. God will not ask us to do what He knows we cannot do. He says He will not test us beyond our faith. Praise the name of Jesus. I will read it again. 1 John chapter 5, verse 3. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not grievous. His commandments are not weighty. They are not heavy. They are things we can do. And God wants us to please Him. He wants us to be obedient. God is simply close to all who show their love to Him by obeying His commandments. By obeying His commandments. Not half obedient. Full obedient. Because half obedience is equals to disobedience. Partial obedience is equals to total disobedience. Hallelujah. When you study the word, you know the likes and the dislikes of God. It says His commandments are not grievous. They are not beyond what we can do. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Father. I pray the Lord will help us with these things in the name of Jesus. I'll just run through them. The steps in knowing God personally. There has to be a deep desire. There has to be intimate fellowship with God. And under that, we have one of the ways of having intimate fellowship with God is having a quiet time. And we said our quiet time is a regular appointment we keep with God. You know, we have another point is building our faith in God. Another one is scriptural revelation, that is studying the word of God, studying to show ourselves approved. And the last one is doing what pleases God. Doing what pleases God. God is waiting for us. If you don't know Him personally and you put these things we've just learned today into actions, you have a relationship with Him. You have a personal relationship with Him. And the Bible says that they that worship the Father, they do it in spirit and in truth. And if you don't know the Father, if you don't know the God you want to worship, there's no way you would worship Him. I pray the Lord will open a heart of understanding in the name of Jesus. I pray that this word that we have had today would yield in hundredfold in our heart in the name of Jesus. I pray that faith will be built up in us today in the name of Jesus. I pray that God will enable us. He would help us. He would strengthen us to do His will and do His biddings alone in the name of Jesus. Father, we'll give praise and we'll give glory to Your name. In Jesus' name, we have prayed. Amen. It is time for the communion. Can we get our elements ready? Let us get ready to partake in the communion. As we know, the communion is a symbol of the finished work of Christ on Calvary. And when we take the bread and wine, it reminds us that Christ has already completed the work for us. Praise the name of Jesus. He delivered us, He saved us, He healed us, He prospered us, and every other thing we could desire. Are we ready with our elements? Can we lift it up to Jesus? Father, we sanctify these elements in the name of Jesus. We pray that it becomes your flesh and your blood. As we partake, we ask that it will do wonders in our lives in the name of Jesus. We ask that it will heal, it will deliver, it will save, and it will bless us in the name of Jesus. We ask that we will not eat this unto condemnation in the name of Jesus. Father, we'll give praise to your name. You can take the bread. And you can drink the wine. Father, we thank you for today. We bless your name, we give praise and we give glory to your name. We thank you for that which we have learned at your feet today. We ask that your word will become life in us in the name of Jesus. I want to encourage us to join us next week, Wednesday, again, as we continue in this series next week, Wednesday, and then we will be, you know, speaking on what is worship. What is worship and what does worship entails? I pray the Lord will keep us and keep us till that time in the name of Jesus. Our services continues on Sunday at 9 a.m. at the King's Chamber Citadel of Favor at 42 Oba Yekini Elegushi Ikate Chisco Bus Stop. We encourage you to join us online. You know, if you cannot come physically, we encourage you to join us online. And we ask that the hand of the Lord will reach out to you wherever you are in the name of Jesus. Father, we give praise and we give glory to your name this evening. Lord, we exalt and we appreciate you. We thank you for another time of your word. We lift up our voices to you in appreciation. We say, blessed be your matchless name in the name of Jesus. We ask, O God, that even as we go tonight, we ask that your presence will go with us in the name of Jesus. We ask that you will help us to know you more and more and more in the name of Jesus. You know, that song says, I want more of you. We ask that you help us to desire, you help us to long more for you in the name of Jesus. Father, we give praise and we give glory to your name. In Jesus' most precious name, we have prayed. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely God's goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. For the Lord will show you, the Lord will show me, the Lord will show us all the paths of life. For in His presence there is fullness of joy, and at His right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Amen. Shalom. Enjoy the rest of the evening. Praise God.